Oh, thanks.
I'd also like to welcome Bailey Galloway from Vista Ridge. She's our student board of representatives, representative tonight. And I think Marie may be on her way. Marie is from Goal Academy. So remember, they're full members of our board, and so they may be asking you questions tonight as well on behalf of our students. And with that, may I have a motion to approve the agenda?
I move to approve the agenda.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none, a vote, please.
Butcher.
Aye.
Graham.
Aye.
Harold.
Aye.
Livia Wright.
Aye.
Moore.
Aye.
Motion carries. We're on to item 4.0, open forum. Do we have anyone signed up to speak tonight? Nope. Perfect. Then we're on to item 5.0, action items 5.01, school finance campaign ballot language.
I move to approve the attached resolution concerning the override levy question.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded, and I believe Mr. Ridgway is going to present the information to us.
Brett Ridgway, Chief Business Officer. You have for your consideration tonight the resolution on the ballot this fall. This is a culmination for me of about 20 months worth of work to bring this to you. I think this is something that we're really happy with. A really good proposal, and the language is really clean. Been working with our council and underwriting advisors here for much of that whole 20-month period as well to bring this to you. So if you have any questions for them, certainly that's what they're here for, to answer those. And I'm here for any you have as well.
Discussion, folks?
We've been discussing this for about 8 months, a year, and I think I'm really proud of the solution we have and the language. I think we're doing the right thing for our constituency and our taxpayers. And it's very fiscally responsible. I've heard a couple other districts comment that they were jealous of our position, that we're in such financially good shape. So it's very creative, and I appreciate everybody's hard work on this. Thank you. It's a good use of our money.
I believe that the outreach that the district has made through Matt and his team and the various other players has been very extensive through the district to the residents. So I do believe that this reflects what I believe to be, you know, the people of D49, the voters, the stakeholders, and whatnot.
I believe this is a blueprint for how to run a district, you know, financially. So I believe that what you've done, Brett, and your team is going to be copied all over the state. I really do, you know, so great job with that. Great job with the language. I thought Dave and you guys and your team did a great job with the language, did exactly what needed to be said legally and purposefully, you know, so great job, you know.
Thank you.
I think this is an incredible plan. We've done an excellent job, I think, of reaching out and asking people what they need for our district. It invests in our entire community, and it does so by staying within the means that our community has already said they were willing to pay in the past. And so having no tax rate increase, yet still being able to provide all of these benefits to our community in terms of new buildings, being able to take care of the property perpetually that we have, and continuing to invest in our teachers to make sure that we stay competitive throughout the 21st century, is an awesome opportunity. And I want to thank our employees for working so hard on coming up with an innovative method to generate this revenue stream that allows our taxpayers to stay at the same tax rate. And with that, let's call for a vote.
Butcher.
Aye.
Graham.
Aye.
Harold.
Aye.
Livia Wright.
Aye.
Moore.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. Here, there's somewhere, guys.
Yeah.
All right, on to item 5.02, approval of intergovernmental agreement for the 2016 general election. Motion, please.
I move to approve the agreement between Falcon School District 49 and the El Paso County Clerk and Recorder as presented, and to adopt the attached resolution stating that the jurisdiction Falcon School District 49 agrees to the terms and conditions of the intergovernmental agreement.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none, a vote.
Butcher.
Aye.
Graham.
Aye.
Harold.
Aye.
Lafia Wright.
Aye.
Moore.
Aye.
Motion carries. We're on to item 5.03, supplemental budget for Fund 31.
I move to approve the supplemental Fund 31 district budget for fiscal year 2015-16 as presented by the administration.
Second.
It's been moved in second, and I believe Ryan Johansson has some things he wants to add.
Yes, Ryan Johansson, accounting group manager. I just want to explain a little bit more of what the supplemental budget is for. When we did the refinance of our debt, it caused some journal entries to be made, and we under-recognized our revenue for budget. We missed that. It's a fairly complicated entry. Some of that money has to be recognized as revenue in the current year. Weird accounting rules. So with that, it moved our revenue up, which allowed us to come to you with a supplemental budget. And in the original budget, we missed the interest payments for the payments in June. So that's what we're really asking for approval, is to increase those expenses to be able to cover those interest payments that were being made.
Thank you for the clarity. Any other comment? And hearing none, a vote, please.
Butcher.
Aye.
Graham.
Aye.
Harold.
Aye.
Lafia Wright.
Aye.
Moore.
Aye.
Motion carries. We're on to 6.0, other business. Anyone have anything to bring? All right, 7.0, adjournment. May I have a motion, please?
I move to adjourn.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none, a vote.
Butcher.
Aye.
Graham.
Aye.
Harold.
Aye.
Lafia Wright.
Aye.
Moore.
Aye.
Motion carries. We're adjourned at 6:38. And we've been asked to consider taking the item on, is it the election report one or is it? Okay, so it says election planning, because we have some folks who are from outside the district who have to drive back to Denver. We'd like to move that up before the other reports so that they can, you know, get back to Denver at a decent hour. So as long as everyone's okay with that, we'll move that ahead of the other agenda items.
Yeah, I'm good.
All right.
Okay, well, I'll begin. Good evening, everybody. Matt Meister, Director of Communications. The information that I provided for you in your packet was just a quick report to let you know that we had done everything up to this point that we had talked about in our communication plan, which was a number of months ago. At this point, I wanted to personally thank you for all of your efforts in supporting, helping us get the word out to the community. We added a few things toward the last 6 weeks, including a teletown hall, which we talked about last time we were together. That was a really successful event, and we thank all of the members of our community who participated in that. And yes, if you have any questions for me, that was really all I had tonight.
I just want to thank you for all your work on this. You've put an incredible amount of time into it. I know there's been a lot of late nights, some of which have felt pretty frustrating at times, because I've been there with you saying, hey. But I know that work is going to pay off, because it's laying the groundwork for what will be happening post-vote. And so I really appreciate your dedication to it and for continuing to kind of push the envelope with us.
It's been my pleasure to serve. So thank you.
Brett Ridgway, Chief Business Officer. I wanted to bring up and introduce Kim Crawford, who's our counsel for election stuff. And now that we are in we've had this milestone of transition now where we've been contemplating, and now that we've passed the resolution in the special meeting here previously, then that changes kind of our context that we need to operate in. And I wanted Kim here to be able to provide you some of that and to answer some questions, any questions you might have in that regard.
Thank you. I'm Kim Crawford. I'm with Butler Snow in Denver. We've worked with the district for many years, and I appreciate you inviting me down. And congratulations on adopting your ballot question. So now, as Brett said, things do change. As of about 2 minutes ago, the Fair Campaign Practices Act came into effect. And as you may or may not know, once a ballot question has been formally adopted, state law forbids school districts or actually any government to do anything to advocate for or against an election. So actually, you know, El Paso County can't do anything about your election either. I mean, it's every election for everything. You can't take any public act or spend any public money. So I know Donna has a little do's and don'ts that I think Brad has prepared. I'm not sure. that I'll look at, you know, I'll look at that. And but she's going to hand it out or distribute it to your employees. As board members, you have a little bit more flexibility because you're not paid. You're not district employees. So you can go out and you can pretty much, you know, advocate, say what you want, do what you want. But what you need to be careful of is where and when you're doing it. School district property, school district time, involving other employees of the school district to go out and do things. You just have to be very cognizant of what's happening. So, I mean, generally, like, school district employees can answer unsolicited questions. So if somebody calls up and says, hey, you know, hey, what's going on with your ballot question? They can answer truthfully. They can give factual information, but they can't advocate. So you just want to be very careful that your employees know, your staff, that people know what they can and can't do during an election. We'll have a Tabor notice that'll come out. You'll have, you know, employee or eligible electors will have an opportunity to do a pro and a con comment, but that's still different than the Fair Campaign Practices Act. The act does allow you to distribute factual information. So if you want to prepare, if you want to have Matt prepare a fact sheet and have it available, you can do that. But it has to contain arguments for and against. Deters districts from even wanting to put it forward because not to vote for it. You know, you may as well not say anything. And what I always tell people is really the only way to avoid any kind of Fair Campaign Practices Act violation allegations is to do nothing, which you may or may not want to do, but you are in a county where there are a lot of Fair Campaign Practices Act allegations and violations or claims of violations. And at points I can tell all kinds of stories, but in the past it used to be kind of in vogue for opponents to file Campaign Finance Act violation claims right before the elections, and then you really don't have time to, you know, to respond because the judges have 30 days to hear the complaints, and then after the election they drop the claim, but the Gazette's already said, you know, Falcon Schools violates the Fair Campaign Practices Act. So there's, you know, political ramifications. There's ways that people actually have tried to manipulate the law, and so that's something you have to, you know, keep in mind as well. So that's just a really kind of a high, over broad.
Okay, so help me understand the consequences.
Okay,
so the consequence is political, as in the Gazette says something bad if someone makes a mistake. Does our ballot question get pulled
No. In
any way, shape, or form by anything if someone misinterprets something we do? No. Because we obviously want to be above board and do things the right way. But many of our employees are also property owners, taxpayers, and parents in this district. And so they may be your kid's second grade teacher, but they may also be someone who has a child in that school, has, you know, and so I get, well, no, you don't sit in your parent in your classroom meeting and tell your parents, but certainly a teacher has the same freedom of speech they walk off that out of their classroom to be able to talk to all of their kids, friends, parents, and absolutely, to their community, because we are a district that truly lives, works, learns, and leads together. And so I want to make sure that clarity is there. And so our consequences are Gazette. Someone might write a letter to the Gazette and say, hey, we think they violated it.
That doesn't matter. It has to be filed with the Secretary of State.
Right.
So they can file appropriately.
Right.
And then they can file a complaint. And then if they file a complaint, what's the worst case scenario that happens to anybody?
You have 30 days to respond. There's an administrative law judge here at the hearing. The judge determines whether or not there's been a violation. If there's been a violation, you can be fined. El Paso, Elbert County, one of the commissioners was actually fined personally a couple years ago. That's the first time that's ever happened. It was like $4,000. I haven't seen any huge fines. A lot of the judges say, you know, you've already spent public money to advocate the election. We don't want to spend public money for you to pay the fine. So, fines are really discretionary. So I haven't seen terrible fines. So I think what we've seen is that the worst part is the bad press.
Okay.
It's not going to affect your ballot question. It doesn't affect the election other than maybe people changing their mind.
Well, and a county commissioner is actually a paid position too. We are unpaid.
Correct.
So as we emphasize over and over, part-time unpaid volunteer position that just happens to be elected. So here's one of the few advantages is, hey, I'm sorry, I'm a volunteer. So I'm going to do a lot of opening my mouth really wide outside the confines of anywhere where I'm anybody's boss personally, because I won't violate the law, but I'm going to educate my fellow parents and neighbors, and I encourage other people to do the same. So
don't be advocating them. You're at a school board meeting on school property. So, I mean, you have to be careful with the school property stuff.
Okay, so now that's the next category. So PTA. They're an outside organization. They're allowed to take positions on the Parent Teacher Association rules. The national rules allow them to take positions on issues, not on candidates. So can they discuss these in their PTA meetings, given they're an outside organization meeting in our school?
They can. You know, if they're meeting in your schools, they can have people come in and speak. The only thing with meeting in your school is that if somebody else who wants to talk about a different issue or even a candidate, you know, mm-hmm. you have to allow everybody the same access to school property. If you charge somebody $25 to use the library for public meetings, it has to be open to whoever wants to use it. I mean, certainly there are board policies about electioneering and electioneering documents that can be distributed on school district property. Most school districts have board policies that prohibit that. So you just want to be careful about what you allow to be distributed. If you allow the PTA to hand out vote yes flyers on back to school night on your property, you're going to need to allow people to hand out vote for Donald Trump, vote for Hillary Clinton, vote for, you know, vote yes on the marijuana tax. I mean, you have to allow, you've created an open forum for First Amendment purposes, and you have to be equal.
So, but if they hold a meeting and they pay rent, then anyone who wanted to exercise that same First Amendment right would have to pay rent just right. Like they did, correct? Mm-hmm. Okay.
What happens if a outside group wants to organize a walk on the weekends? How will they let our staff know? Is there any way for them to let our staff know that they're going to organize some type of a walk like that to go door to door?
That's a little bit trickier because, you know, giving out staff email addresses or putting things in your staff flyers is hard because you don't want to be seen as advocating. Not sure how most district how others have addressed that. I mean, certainly anybody can walk on weekends, and you know, if they want to stand outside of the school property, like on the street, and hand things to people as they're leaving. Don't put something in the kids' Friday folders, you know. But if they want to try to give things to people as they're leaving, like at a football game, if they want to pass out flyers still off of the property, you know, you can try to do something like that. You just need to be careful of where the school property starts and the political activity starts.
What about encouraging our constituents to vote?
Can do that.
So we could have, like, you know, signs and things around on school property encouraging our constituents to vote on this particular ballot.
I wouldn't even say a ballot issue. I would just say, you know, there's going to be an election. You could say that the board has adopted a resolution to put this on the ballot. We encourage you to become informed, to be aware, and to get out and vote.
So I'm saying that actually for Matt's benefit, I don't know what role you're going to have since the die has been cast, so to speak. So
do it on his own time.
And he's donated a heck of a lot of time to this.
If you're distributing factual information,
right?
About your ballot question, I mean, he can do it on school district time if he's presenting, if he's preparing a factual summary or fact sheet or something like that. Mm-hmm. He just has to be sure that the information contains arguments for and against. So if anybody does file a claim, you can at least go to the judge and say, look, we complied with the law. This is what the law says. And then the judge will say, maybe he'll say it's still too positive. You know, I've seen a lot of things where, and this is true, is that, you know, schools fall apart and there are leaking roofs and there are rusted pipes and mm-hmm. they take pictures and it's all facts. It's you walk into the school, that's what it looks like. And the judges have said that is too far because it's pushing people to vote yes. It's without saying vote yes, you're saying vote yes because you're saying, look at this, you know, look at this.
You're inferring voting yes.
Inferring voting yes because yeah. you're being too positive in your
facts. Right. So that may be a.
So you could talk to Mr. Bell and he could tell you how much you need.
But then the consequence would be the judge says, oop, that you violated and you may have a fine.
Yes.
Right. Okay.
It's not going to hurt your ballot. It's not going to.
This is my question.
Nothing going to overturn the election.
So what I hear you saying is board members can advocate, staff can advocate, but on their own time, not on school property. Okay, how does this affect students who are not anybody to, you know, as a pay, as far as the district gets pays?
Well, as in they have.
I'm sorry. I misspoke and was taken out of context. They're definitely somebody, but they're not.
They're not paid employees.
So how does that affect them?
Students can also get involved. They still can't do it on school property. They still can't do it in school time. So if Bailey wants to form some sort of public interest student group that meets after school, hope, you know, maybe at the public library instead of the school library or something.
We actually have a policy that allows students to have student organized groups meet on our property for all kinds of reasons. It's actually in our packet, interestingly enough, for review. That's a fairly liberal policy that allows them to form around any, pretty much anything they want. Correct, any student initiated thing. So we can have student initiated groups meet before or after school on school property for all kinds of things. We're fairly liberal on those things in our district because we believe in our students having a voice.
She asks you, or if she wants to use a school laptop or a school computer at the library, arguably you could say you're not spending any money because it's already there. You know, it's not any additional cost for them to use that. But I would be very careful with providing school resources or letting her make photocopies or and handing things out. You don't want to do that on school property.
What about the board meetings?
I wouldn't hand it out of board meetings either.
Well, I'm talking about a board member advocating.
I would not encourage you to do that at a board meeting.
Okay.
Because you're still on school property.
Not saying that I ever would, because the die has been
cast.
No one
would ever do that.
Okay. I'm just asking.
You're still on school property. And
school property.
You can argue that you're not spending any money to advocate. I will tell you that. There was a city that was, they were on public television.
Right.
That, mm-hmm. And one of the council members did get up and say, you know, this is great. We need to do this. Mm-hmm. There was a complaint filed. I believe that they were found to have not violated the Fair Campaign Practices Act.
But it's getting there.
But I think when you're doing stuff like that, you're drawing attention. And it, especially in places that really are politically active and you've got a lot of constituents who are well-informed, you know, it might fly in. No offense meant, but like in, you know, Montezuma County or Kit Carson County, where they just don't have as many people who are as actively involved. I think El Paso County's got a huge political constituency that they people are informed in El Paso County.
Excuse me, just out of curiosity then, even at a board meeting though, if a student or someone from a public parent, business, whatever, stakeholder comes up and addresses during our open forum, we just listen.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And you can answer unsolicited questions. And any of your, even on on staff can do it on in school district time. If somebody calls you, if the newspaper calls you or sends you an email, or any of your staff members, they send you an email, what's this about? They can answer unsolicited questions. You can go, you know, they can, if the Chamber of Commerce says, hey, come present at, you know, if you want to send Brett to a meeting, I would just recommend that he say that I'm on my own time. You know, I'm here at your request. Because of the Fair Campaign Practices Act, I can't spend any public money, but I'm here on my own time. And then he can mark in his little calendar, I'm here doing this personal time, you know, and Brett saying, yeah, thanks.
Well, but we can go.
You can go.
The five of us can go no matter what, and we're not under any obligation to present pro and con.
If three of you go together, you have to call meetings.
Right, yeah, well, we're good at that part. We figured that rule out pretty hardcore here.
Kim, I'd like to just compliment you on the ballot language. I think you made our job easier because the priorities and the commitment we're making to the taxpayers on how we spend the money is very clear. And we're forming a covenant by putting that language out there. I thought you did a great job. And I think that makes our job a lot easier. And I appreciate that. And
staff worked very, very hard on
this. Yeah, they did. We've got a great team. Thank you.
You are really in a unique situation, the way that your debt is paying off right now. So other districts, as you say, might be jealous, but they.
Well, how many districts are going to end up with no general obligation bond debt?
They'll be the only ones that I know of.
That's why we're different, is we've paid off our bonds. And that's important. That's we honored our commitment the last time we were awarded the money. So let us live within our budget. It's good.
You've worked for this. It's.
Yeah, that's all, you know, a lot of this Brett, you know, when times were tough, you know, budget was tight, you made right moves and you made right decisions. You know, it was hard decisions, but you made right decisions and brought us to this point where we're able to do that. Like I said, this is going to be a blueprint for other districts, hopefully, you know, in order to for them to be a little bit more successful with the bond issues. So thank you guys very much.
And certainly if something comes up where you're not sure what to do, certainly you're welcome to email me or let me know, or call Brett and he can, you know, Peter, they know how to contact me. Don't call David. I know.
I can figure this out. Matt will help you.
You'll have to go back.
Good evening. I'm Monica Dines Henderson, the Director of Nutrition Services. And we're just going to give a quick overview of what my department did last year. So the 2015-16 wrap-up, we had 132,350 breakfasts, bringing in a total of $173,306 in reimbursement. And either that's federal reimbursement dollars are the co-pay from the students who are full price. At lunch, we did 924,437, bringing in 1,396,793. On the a la carte side, we only brought in, and I shouldn't put it we only brought in to make it sound like it's a bad thing. A la carte is more of the free kind of free choice offerings that kids like. that's not necessarily the healthiest food choices. So I'm really proud about my staff and my whole department. We encourage kids to take a complete reimbursable meal so they get good food choices, good nutrition versus just buying 5 bags of chips. So a la carte is lower because of that. On the catering side, we brought in $48,795. Revenue to expenses, our revenue was $3.6 million plus, and that was 105.19% of the budget target. And then expenses came in at $3.4 million plus at 99.54% of our budget, giving us a profit of $195,000. This is just a nice little graph that shows you where our money's really spent at. This really falls into the national standards for our program. Most of our money should always be spent on the food and the supplies for the food and then our labor. So you can see we run on really short margins here. We did do our second year of summer food program. We were able to provide 657 breakfasts to the little kiddos and big kiddos, because they can come in up to 18 years old, who did get up and have breakfast over at Evans. That was in 24 days worth of service. So we did get 1,311 back in federal reimbursement on that. Again, because we worked at we made income this year, we were able to contribute back to the district's general fund. I shouldn't say contribute back, because we don't take money from the district at all. We're self-operative. So we were able to contribute or donate $50,000 back to the general fund. And I wanted that to sound like a PBS blurb. Please, you know, contribute your funds and help, you know, support PBS. Instead, support the general fund here. So our current free and reduced percentages for this year, and please, these numbers will not match what the October 1 count is, because I can only claim and put in for the students who are in schools that participate in the National School Lunch and Breakfast programs. So Goal Academy, those ones who don't have a meal program, capture their data, they're captured in a different. So the students that are in a school with a meal program, we have a total of 26.23% receiving free and reduced benefits. You can see the breakdown of that. One thing I really want to stress with this is that means that one in every four of our students in this district are living in a house that has food insecurities. And I think we need to keep that in mind when we go, you know, the teachers go to educate them in the morning and things, that one in every four kiddos may not have had breakfast. So they may not be ready to learn, because they have food insecurities in their own household. Big things in my horizon, reauthorization happens every 5 years. It was already supposed to have happened, but Congress is not in their happy place over this, for lack of better words. So they're still trying to negotiate. Both the Senate and the House came out with their proposed plans. They do not match. The Senate would be better for our district than the House, but the Senate does not do anything substantial to help our program in this district. So we're still running on an extension. We probably will until after the national presidential election. Then USDA just released about 2 weeks ago the final rules for the wellness policy implementation. The big things on this one is it will require the local education authorities' wellness policy to include standards for other non-foods or non-sold foods and beverages made available on the school campus during the school day. We have a very proactive wellness policy already with our guidelines, so we're in a good spot for this. We don't have to go back and make more requirements of our families for classroom parties and things, because we're pretty in a good spot right there. The big one that I see impacting the district is in-school marketing of food and beverage items must meet competitive food standards. So they have to be smart snack. So your Culver's Nights, Culver's doesn't have things that make the, or they don't sell the things that make meet the stringent requirements that are required of Smart Snack, which is the 200 calories or less, the first item being whole grain, our fruit, our vegetable, or a combination of both, and we can go down there, but we won't. So that's going to be hard because you're not even going to be able to speak about Culver's. You can't orally, written, or in any way market any kind of food items that are not compliant. So that's going to be an interesting road to go down. Doesn't go into effect till July 1. You have a whole year to figure out creative ways to minimize that impact on the schools for the fundraising and things there. And I'd like to emphasize creative.
So I was going to say, there's no regulation that says how far away ads can be from school projects. Does it have to be like, so someone could, PTA, moms are awesome, can stand with a sign technically off school property next to the park. Like at exactly. Stetson Park, we can stand with our sign at Stetson Park saying Culver's Night Tonight, right?
Right. It's okay. Kind of like the election deal.
Exactly.
Nothing on school property.
This is what I'm thinking, right? We can find a way.
Exactly. Again, creative. Be creative.
Is that federal or state?
This is federal.
I see. Federal's telling us what we can eat and where we can eat now. I just wanted to make sure I understand that.
You are, yes. Yes.
John would also like the name of the person that made that roll up. We'll take a trip.
I won't go to the influences on that. Let's see. And then the last piece, and you'll hear more about that in the upcoming year. And Rachel, our wellness director, will talk more about that too. And see, the last piece is local education authority must assess compliance with its local school wellness policy and make the assessment available to the public at least once every 3 years. Currently, it is once every year, so that's kind of nice that we don't have to make it available every year, but we have to do it every 3 years. And this is basically my department's goals for this upcoming year, the things we're working on. We are going to do a second annual food expo. It was very successful and well attended at Vista Ridge by the kids, and it was really fun to get their input. A lot of the things that they liked there, you will now see on our menu this school year. And of course, be engaged in the reauthorization process because it impacts us everywhere, including how we market to our kids for fundraisers. Start new program at Power Technical Early College campus. They were supposed to start September 6th. They're having a delay in their construction. I'm not really sure what day we will start providing them the services because of that delay. And then we are starting a breakfast program at Imagine Indigo Ranch. It starts September 1st. And we are going to be providing services this year to Spring Studio because they are based at Falcon Legacy Campus and we already have a meal program there. And our big goal is to reinvest in our equipment in some of our older schools. And that might prevent the contribution to the general fund for next year because we're going to put some money back into our department. And that is that. Any questions?
Thank you. I know you're just the messenger of the bad news, but we'll find a way to deal.
It's just a great challenge.
And I just wanted to compliment you on the culture that it seems like you've created from your survey. Your staff feels very valued, and that is a reflection on you as their leader that you've given them that purpose and that showing them that they're part of our district. So thank you for doing that for them.
Thank you.
Make sure they know how much we appreciate them.
Yes, I will.
Please, thanks.
Yeah, I also want to commend Monica and her staff for really, being one of the very few that are historically are making a profit in HERS, because HERS really actually runs more like a business than any department that we have in the school district. So I want to thank you for your efforts because it's not easy to do.
Well, everybody have a good night.
So Nancy Lamond has the job descriptions. She's left. Yeah, so Peter, you have that one? Anyone have questions on either?
I will come around if there are questions.
Only question was assistive technology assistant. Is that just a thing we, someone's already essentially doing the job, we just didn't have a correct job description? Okay.
You know, just a comment, you used the acronym SWAC with no definition of what it was in the job description. So I would like to guess what it was. What is it? What is it? In all seriousness, people,
it's assistive communication. I believe it is state. I'm not sure what the W is. It's assisted communication. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Reasonable.
When the stuff, they have no clue what it is, and I'm feel that way on the board a lot.
Google thinks it's the Senior Women Academic Administrators of Canada, but we know that that
I knew it.
Is not actually true.
My kid uses SWAC, and I still don't know what
it is. The This is why it won't roll off anyone's tongue. It is the Statewide Assistive Technology Augmentative and Alternative Communications Department.
Okay, so I still don't know what it means.
So it has to do with individuals, students who use different kinds of technologies, communications boards. Sometimes they use communications technologies that moderate or accommodate a visual or learning impairment of some kind, or they may use communications boards, a broad category that can include a device which when the student touches it will generate speech or will generate responses to questions. So all of those are considered assistive or augmentative technologies.
Yeah, they literally handle everything from a communication to board that a child touches so that the device speaks to them, to an iPad that does the writing for a child because their hand doesn't write, to something that will interpret things for you if you can't hear so that you can read. Anything that involves technology to help them move, to help compensate for a disability. So it's a pretty cool set of people. They do some cool stuff.
Yeah, and really the point, I think our transparency to our community is sometimes lost in our use of acronyms. And that's really the point I'm trying to make. Thanks.
And that's well taken. I want to know one other thing. I believe we have a title discrepancy between what's in the cover sheet and what we actually want it to be. The cover sheet, I think, shows assistant. That's actually going to be technician. That too will be fixed for the next meeting.
Okay, and so with that, let's move those forward to September 8th, please. And now we're on to the Cultural Compass Review, which is Dr. Fletcher and Mr. Meister.
Dr. Lou Fletcher, the Cultural Compass Review. We've had some pretty monumental events in the district this year in terms of climbing the peak for students and also having base camp. And those don't go unnoticed. We want to make sure that those events that affect our culture don't just become isolated events that don't have any connection to our culture going forward in the future. So that's part of what Checking the Cultural Compass will be about, and also getting out to listening to the voice of the workforce, or our work family, as we've coined it now. So we'll have some presentation in terms of what we want to do going forward, and also some reflection on what we did for those two events.
Yeah, talking about coining something, do you guys have any more of those coins that we gave out that day? Oh, good.
Did you like them?
I did, and I gave all mine out and didn't keep one for myself. So
I gave all mine out as well, but I kept one for myself. part of why I asked that Dr. Fletcher and Mr. Meister be on this agenda item, and I want to speak to it as well, is that they together are kind of the most most prominent advocates of the cultural compass. We all speak to it, we all work to it, but they have opportunities to represent it in all kinds of settings. And so you were at the base camp and you saw that was a strategic event, but it was also very much a cultural event. And as part of our desire to listen more to our workforce, to listen more to the people that make up the community, we did a survey, a voluntary survey after the base camp. And I wanted to just report to you, we had very good participation. It's actually still open. There's still the possibility that people will contribute, but we've seen the number of responses really trail off this last week. So we think our numbers are pretty solid at this point. We had almost 400 respondents, which is a lot given the size of our staff. And it indicates that our staff is willing to give us feedback. I think that what Mr. Meister and Mr. Fletcher have done over the last 18 months, particularly with the survey on our district calendar, with the survey related to cannabinoid use and administration, with multiple surveys, both before and especially after weather events, like how did we do? And we report those back out transparently. We're extremely willing to share when we're being praised, and we're willing to share when we're not being praised or being criticized. And so we think that's increased the percentage of participation in our surveys, but there were some very significant signal responses after the base camp. And if you look at our strategic rocks, you know that trust, we always talk about reestablishing trust as one of our highest values. It's our first strategy, kind of a foundational strategy, and being respectful, transparent, accountable, and caring, how we treat each other in the inner ring of the compass. Those are all trust building values in District 49. And so I just wanted to report to you, we're generating a written report that's going to come out to you as it comes out to the entire staff. But I wanted to report to you that when we asked our staff, the 383 respondents, 8.92% said that District 49 had earned the community's trust, and 8.92 strongly agreed that we had earned the community's trust, and 51.44 agreed, 31 were neutral, but less than 8% disagreed with that statement. And those of you that have been around a while know that that is a complete inversion of where we were at even 5 years ago. And so our staff is recognizing, and they're closest to our community, they're recognizing that the cultural compass that you as a board originally commissioned, even though you didn't say go make a compass, you said go build our cultural capacity. And so that was a project that Mr. Anderson and I worked on initially that led in part to the hiring of Dr. Fletcher. It has created all kinds of structure for the communications department, and it seems to be paying off with the staff that work here, that increased sense that our community is trusting us. There were some other things, and I will save some of those for the formal report that is coming, but we even had strong agreement, in fact, even stronger agreement, that the district makes responsible financial decisions. And so for our staff, who, as we know, are not, you know, not wallowing in excess funds compared to all of our neighboring districts, for our staff to agree, and they were over 70% that we make responsible financial decisions. That is a really big deal. And it's part of where our culture is bringing us. So I wanted to report that to you. I'm gonna invite Dr. Fletcher just to mention where we are heading with our, we'll have a special announcement for you at the Fantastic 49, but he's been getting some feedback as the school gets going on our restorative practices, which is also a significant part of our culture.
Okay, one of the things that I'm happy to report is last year, I think was a very monumental year in the school district, and we went through and we got to the point of doing a resolution to make sure that restorative practices would be what we start with for conduct and discipline for this year. I did some work over the summer getting together policies and put them out there, and you guys approved, so thank you very much for that. Let me apply my expertise to that. But a parallel process was last year working with the Military Child Education Coalition's Technical Assistance Center to put together an application for a grant with the Department of Defense Education Activity. And one of the things that I said as we had the vision for this is that I didn't want resources to be a limiting factor in what we're doing with restorative practices. So intentionally, I asked for no money, no funds. Everything was always, you know, I don't need to look at that. Let's look at the structure and the policy, how that works. But we got informed at the end of July, I think it was July 26th, that our application was successful. So to fund the restorative practices program for the next 5 years, we are going to get $1.5 million from the Department of Defense Education Activity, which is going to be about $300,000 a year. And that has some other exciting pieces to it. Now, the focus is the core military schools. Now, some of you may or may not know, we have 10 schools in a district that had a qualifying military population, a number of students in it. So the way that I helped to craft the grant was that for us to make sure that our students had the right environment, it couldn't just include those schools. We had to do measures outside of those schools because, like I said, you can't just change part of the water in a fish tank. You got to change it all. So for our environment, our culture to be right for this, we have to make sure that it's ubiquitous for everybody in the district. So with that, I'll say the name of the program. I didn't want to say the name at all before because I wanted to make sure that we actually got it. But the program is going to be called BRIGHT. And what that stands for is Building Restorative Interventions, Growing Honorable Traditions. That's the program, because it's a program that goes to some of the policies that were changed. It's about character development. It's about not having bullying. It's about addressing conduct and discipline. So it has many different uses. And this year is the planning year. There'll be some training and those kind of things happening this year. And then we'll have a more grand program for 2 years after that called Safer Saner Schools. It'll be available to all of the schools, and we'll be working this year to structure how that gets put in place. And with the proposal that I gave to you and what I gave out to the Department of Defense, it was based on the cultural compass. Students being accountable, but we can't have them so much accountable that we don't care for them, because then that's being zero tolerant. You know, we don't want to be punitive. We also don't want to do the thing where we don't have an accountability. We don't care about them. We just don't do anything for them. That's just neglect. It talked about the fact that, you know, we could do everything for them, but doesn't prepare them from anything. It makes them entitled. It makes them not ready for the world. What we want to do in School District 49, which is right there on the compass, high accountability, high caring, to make sure we're working with students. And if you care for somebody, you respect them. If you don't care for them, you can't not care and not respect. And with the transparency piece, if you're being very accountable and you're doing the right thing and caring, you want everybody to know about it. If you're just being overly punitive, you probably are not very transparent, because you don't want them to know what you're doing to the students. So this, combined with the efforts of base camp and also climbing the peak and efforts we have going forward, are things that we're doing with the community to solidify that the cultural compass is something that we actually live with and we actually work through. And I think that's the sentiment we want to deliver here today.
Do you have any questions for Dr. Fletcher or for me about our cultural compass or what we've just shared with you?
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Well done. Well, you know, wow.
$300,000
a year, right? Yeah.
Wow. So part of our agreement is to collaborate with local military entities to hire a manager and a coordinator. I'm not going to get the titles right because it's brand new.
Yeah, what we're going to have is a BRIGHT project manager, and that's included within the grant, and that's funded. We're also going to have a military student transition consultant who's going to work with all of our military students as they come into the district, take care of their needs as they go through the district, things like the Military Interstate Compact, to make sure that's taken care of, because it's coming from the DOD, and that's part of what was written in there. And what happens is, with our military family life counselors we already have out in the district, what helps the military students will help the rest of the students in the district as well, those resources.
So as we're developing those job descriptions, we're doing that collaboratively with our military partners. So it's a little different process than we normally follow. But we will be bringing those back this way. We're actually very excited that we get to hire those people this year. Even though it's a planning year, we get to get that extra human resource, and it's sustainable for the 5 years of the grant, plus any possible additional extensions that we will apply for beyond that. So this is a great opportunity for the district to put real feet to the cultural compass and to extend it grades K-12 across every single school. And I appreciate the opportunity to congratulate Dr. Fletcher on his leadership of our culture and services, because this reinforces our culture and it definitely is going to serve our students. So if there are no other questions, I will say thank you, but we'll get to celebrate this grant at our fantastic 49. Since that's not formally part of the board meeting, I appreciate the opportunity to share the good news with you here.
Awesome job. I'm excited. Okay, so our next item is enrollment update from Ron Sprintz.
Good evening, board. Ron Sprintz, Finance Group Manager. Let me get oriented here. All right. So I just want to realign the board about what happens this time of year. You know, we build our budget for the school year based on two major variables. This is the majority of our money, a per pupil amount that's given to the state, and then we multiply that by the number of students that are in our district. So it becomes pretty necessary for us early on to understand, you know, how close we estimated when we were doing that budget. Lots of decisions are made with, you know, personnel at different schools. If they're over enrollment and they're wanting to know if they can get an extra hand here or there. And so understanding these numbers helps me communicate with them whether they can or whether they need to be a little, they need to hold off on something because the numbers aren't coming in. So I'm going to show you what I have here, kind of orient you to the graphs and kind of show you the summary of what we're seeing right now. I'll be back probably every 2 weeks here to just give the board an update of where we're at. And I just know that we're constantly looking at it and we're working with the spenders of the money to know where they're at as well. Okay, so Falcon Zone, I'm going to put them up next. I developed these graphs. I believe I developed these last year and I added some clarity to it. I have some updates that I'll hand out after, but I'll go through these numbers as we said. So last year, where's the pointer on here there? I started this process this year in mid to late July. Last year, I didn't really start the asking for counts until I want to think first week of August or somewhere around there. So I wanted to just kind of see a little more of a trend on how things happen as the summer kind of ends on us. So you can see Falcon Zone here. I have the total Falcon Zone up at the top here, and this is based on the right side of the graph here. The rest are the schools. You can see the key or legend over here. The schools are down here and they're based on the left side of this graph. So you can see at the beginning, you know, we had some pretty significant increases and we slowly started coming down as the school year started up. Last week, we saw a very significant drop in our student counts. And so I wanted to see if we saw the same thing happen this week. So you'll see down on the dates down here that, you know, I'm going at kind of a weekly intervals here, and then I start 15, 16, 17, and then I got 18, 19, and then 22nd. I just wanted to see what happened during that week. Last year at this time, we saw a pretty significant drop, and that week was the week that D20 and D11 started their enrollment. We did not see the same type of drop this year that we saw last year. And again, I'll show you on the graphs. On the new graphs, I've kind of put a line to show you that week and the activity that happened, but we did not see drastic decreases. So now that I show you the Falcon Zone, it's pretty darn close as far as their budget. Sand Creek, you can see, is tailing off a little bit. Power Zone, kind of the same. Everyone's kind of has that same kind of pattern. And then the iConnect Zone, you can see they actually have been slowly increasing, even though they are fairly down below budget. And so had some numerous meetings discussing some of the options there. To zoom in on this a little bit. So this final sheet, the summary page, really just takes that graphical representation and just kind of puts numbers behind everything. So you can see here's the numbers we based our budget on for fiscal year 17. This is the current counts as I get them. That's the current Infinite Campus counts. And then the ups or downs related to that school. And then this is the normalized revenue that goes along with those kiddos to each zone, showing kind of, or not kind of, but what the potential up or increase or decrease will happen. And then, so the important part I try to emphasize is where they're at a zone level. So you can see at this point, Falcon Zone was down 30, is potentially going to be down 37K. Again, this is very early on in the count process. The final numbers don't come in until the October count, which doesn't get finalized till mainly usually December. But if you remember last year, it didn't get finalized till January or even mid-February.
The counts got finalized in December. They just didn't adjust funding until
they didn't adjust March. Funding, correct. So you can see Sand Creek down 284, Power Zone down 413, and then some significant down in iConnect Zone at 1.1 million. Again, very early on in this stage, where you know we've already met with a number of the zone leaders and principals, for that matter, to discuss different situations. So again, I'm just trying to orient you on where we're at. I do have some updates that I'll hand out afterwards that shows where we were at as of Monday. Any questions?
So yeah, I see a lot of homes being built all over the place.
Yes, sir.
That is not reflected in the increase in student attendance at all.
Yeah, we're not seeing that come to fruition yet. You know, I would just be guessing right now. Mm-hmm. To tell you the truth, I don't have answers as to why we're not seeing those numbers come in.
But these are estimates, right, of where we thought we would be?
Correct.
So, okay.
My concern is the iConnect, $1 million. You know, how are they going to be able to?
Yeah, that's going to be a significant hurdle, definitely.
Mr. Moore, I'd like to speak to a little bit of that, although Mr. Franco and the principals would have more detail. In general, there's two dynamics that are happening in the iConnect zone, and they both center around changed or new schools. So you can see specifically in the numbers that our projections for Pikes Peak Early College were significantly higher than actual enrollment. That has in part to do with the timing of when the state board approved Pikes Peak Early College. I don't know if you remember, but they took it off of a consent agenda. They came back around and had a conversation, and then they approved it. So that changed the dynamic. Typically, you want students to be enrolling, and especially in high school, they're registering for courses in February. This school was approved in later April, and so that really affected our ability to recruit students. We will draw students to that school, but we weren't going to draw them after they'd already made a commitment to be somewhere. And that's not a fault of any, it's not the state board's fault, it's not really a fault in the projections. Those projections had to generate a viable school on its own. Its budget had to be sustainable on its own. You're not allowed to subsidize in the application phase the way you are allowed to subsidize in actual operations of a district. And so although that number is a big scary number, we are already reducing some of those costs. We're already, we've had some very serious and detailed meetings about where our current staff loads are, what services we're providing, whether we can allocate some of the expertise at that school to other programs within the district, and we can, and we've already started doing that. And we had a different but related issue with projections, with enrollment below projections at Patriot High School, mostly having to do with the fact that we changed the night school schedule, and it simply did not draw as well as we projected. So we changed it to a 3-session model, but that third session is not night enough, it's not late enough in the evening, that it has not drawn as well as we projected. So we're learning, and that's part of what we do in our cycle of learn, work, and lead. We are working very hard with Brett and his team, as well as the iConnect zone and the other zone leaders as well. We're working to accommodate that deficit, but we are not losing $1 million. We already know for certain that that will not happen. Correct. It's projection, it's actual to projection.
Well, and PLC's numbers tend to increase a little as the year goes on too, because sometimes kids start to need to realize that AEC will be a better placement for them. But some of those decisions aren't necessarily made the first time for a child until they've maybe experienced ninth grade for a quarter or semester, and then they end up saying, I need a different placement.
I can give you a specific example where following our cultural compass to be transparent probably cost us some enrollment. Our first meetings for Pikes Peak Early College, PPEC, were at Spring Studio. But that's not where PPEC is going to be housed. It's not where it's operating. It's operating at the Falcon Legacy campus. So we moved those meetings so that students and parents would see the actual facility. That may have cost us some enrollment, but we would rather be honorable up front and lose some enrollment than have people feel like they experience debate and switch. So having been through this with 3 other schools sort of like this in other parts of my career, this school will grow dramatically. Falcon Virtual Academy served 59 students in its first year. 7 years later, we served 500 students. So PPEC is going to grow significantly, but it's not going to grow in time to meet projections in year one.
Okay, any other questions?
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Ron. And so next is our monthly financial report from Ryan.
Ryan Johansson, Accounting Group Manager. First off, I'd like to thank the board and Matt's team for the base camp. The accounting and finance teams really enjoyed it. And they're not a crowd to get excited about much, but they really enjoyed it, and they were asking when we could do it again. So thank you. I'd like to look at the financial package. This is our best guess right now of how things will look for the annual financial report. There may be a few audit adjustments, but we think we're pretty close on this, much better than in years past. First, I'd like to go through this this first page. It's on page 3. This is Fund 10. On the left-hand side is the revenues, the different ways that the district brings revenue in. You can see that revenue in total over the local revenue was slightly higher than projected, and the main variance is coming in from the charter school purchase services, which is good for the district. Moving down to the state, we're at 99.7% of projection, which is a pretty good estimate. The slight downfall was with the CTE program. We kind of knew that was going to come in a little bit lower, but the other programs made it up. Then in the federal, the other federal resources, various grants and impact aid, things like that come in at almost 96%. So that's, you know, compared to our high standard, it's low, but it really good. And once you go down, is that minus the total revenue, that's revenue transfers to fund other funds, our capital projects, the preschool, health insurance fund, and then that big number is money that we send through the charters. This is not money the district loses. Just want to emphasize that we are a pass-through entity for these charter schools. If they weren't here, that money would not come to us. So we just get it and pass it right on to them. So we end the year at 99.6% of our budget. So a very, very high standard that we're meeting on that.
One thing I'd like to chime in on that is on the impact aid section on the federal, we've been working with a consultant over the course of the spring and summer here to change our practices, our reporting style and everything on impact aid. And it's going to dramatically impact that revenue stream, perhaps as much as doubling that entire revenue stream in the future. So that's exciting to look forward to.
Always nice to have some extra money or lying around. On the right-hand side is the top is a summary, another summary of the revenue. Then we go down through expenses. Total instructional spend came in slightly lower than projected, which open positions, not spending on supplies, whatever, that kind of thing, helped out. And then he's dropped down to the support service. Once again, this one is significantly under budget, planned with savings across multiple categories. Down to the total fund balance change, that line in green, the fund balance decreased by $300,000, which compared to the planned decrease of $2.5 million is a significant savings to the district. So we did a really good job of working within the budget and spending the money wisely. So any questions on that general fund?
I just think those statistics are pretty amazing. Given the number of line items we have in a budget for an organization this size, to all of the planning and communicating that goes on to have that percentage come up, that's just plain amazing to me.
Many businesses would be impressed and be throwing parties for getting this close. So they've done a good job.
We had cake today.
Oh, right. Well, let's talk
about take some extra back to the finance group for tomorrow.
I was going to talk about nutrition, but Monica already tooted her own horn, so we will pass on that. Next, I thought I'd talk about transportation. We're at the end of the school year, so good time to look at transportation and how they did. To orient you on this page, the top left-hand side is the Fund 10 revenue expenses. The bottom left is the fee-for-service Fund 25 expenses. And transportation is within those two. The fee-for-service is not a self-sustaining fund. Even though we charge for rides, it does not cover the full cost of transportation. And then, Matt, if you want to move over to the right, top right, that section adds the two together. Starting with the revenue, the other subsidy is the general fund subsidy giving to fund 25 to keep it solvent, to keep it going. So that is the board's contribution for free and reduced students. We walk down, there's the transportation revenue, the fee for service revenue. We do get a state subsidy, came in higher than budgeted. And then the field trips, the transportation activity fund, sports events, all that is the next line down. It came in some miscellaneous revenue. So revenue came in higher than projected for transportation in total, 122% of projection. We drop down to the expense side. You want to go up just a little bit?
Just and that 122%, you can see it is driven by those external sources. And then the internal source is what gets the benefit of that, the internal subsidy the general fund would provide to balance that out. So when we have greater revenue sources from the external, that is a big benefit to the general fund.
We have expenses coming down. Just want to hit in total. The expenses were slightly higher than projected, but more than enough revenue to make up for that. But that doesn't tell all the story. If you drop down to that bottom section, which is the total rides for the year. We saw an increase over the prior year of almost 300,000 rides. So that's a significant increase in rides. It's about 5% increase over the prior year in rides. And that's across all categories of rides, the free and reduced rides, and the sped. the free and reduced and the sped drive rides have a higher cost to the district, but they were still able to stay within a pretty good margin of expenses for that big increase in rides. If you go up to that next up one category to the total expense for transportation, you see it costs the district just under $2 million to operate the transportation in total. So not a good or bad, just a, that's what it costs.
But again, that $2 million number, before we went to a fee for service model, that $2 million was almost four. That was almost a $4 million net cost to the district. So the fee for service program definitely has impacted, not only just on the revenue side, but it helps control the cost side as well with the route structure.
I guess an overall opinion is that Gene and his department do a really good job of keeping the cost down and making sure that the kids are safe and getting to school on time.
So I don't see it here. Maybe I'm missing it, probably. But what about the new buses? Where would that
so
be?
New buses happen every year out of the capital fund. Fund 15. And so this year we are buying four new buses, mm-hmm. which is, I think, the same as what we did last year.
Okay.
I think that's going to be covered under the chief reports at the end, right?
Yeah, I think it's in Gene's actual report section.
Yeah, the bus purchases are a capital expense and not an everyday management expense. So different fund. Any other questions about the report in total or? Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Team Forest, for me.
Okay, so the next is policy additions for service animals.
So if I may speak from here, Dr. Lamond is actually on her way to take a child to college at 6 a.m. And so with my enthusiastic permission, she is on her way. I'm familiar with this policy. She and I have talked about it. We have had the occasion to have service animals in our building, sometimes with guests and sometimes with students, but we don't have a policy framework for that. And there is an existing policy framework in Colorado. So this is your opportunity as a board to consider adopting a structure so that if we had non-standard requests or potentially non-standard service animals, we would have a policy framework to evaluate that request. There are places in the country where individuals have requested animals other than dogs. We normally think of dogs as service animals. That's kind of the iconic image. But there are places where other things like miniature horses have been approved as service animals or therapy animals. And so because there are other environmental impacts from other kinds of animals, including sometimes dogs, we wanted to offer you this policy and see if you had any questions about it.
Do we have anyone currently in our district asking about this?
We have a permitted service animal, and it's permitted because to not permit it would, since we don't have a policy framework, not permitting it would expose us to some complaint, and we would probably not want to prevail. We want to be able to support members of our community, including students. So we have permitted it, but that's what mission about. Well, permitted it based on what policy haven't adopted yet out of the CASB sample pot of policies.
And then one question that I was wondering is if there's a child that's allergic to an animal, would they be moved if they were in a classroom? Would that?
So as we would with other kinds of potential environmental considerations, we might make accommodations within the classroom. There are conditions where we might move the student out of, we might move the allergic student out of the presence of the animal or vice versa. And that's something that schools manage pretty well. It generally has to do with good information and then a good accommodations plan for the student.
So it seems in these policies that what we're looking at more than a physical ailment such as sight problems or hearing problems, we're looking more at emotional and psychological issues for the service animal, Right.
So there is not currently policy that would allow an animal as what is called a therapy dog. Because the chief education officer would like a therapy miniature horse, and I've been told that would not be allowed. Nobody has yet made that case or won that right to have an animal for purely social emotional purposes. But the law doesn't really make a distinction between physical disability and social emotional conditions. And so it's possible that there could come a point where an individual, a student or a guest in our community or a member of our staff would make that request, and we would have to deal with that. But what this policy does is it gives us a lot of ways to say yes for a lot of appropriate reasons. We do. We have to permit. I would say a reasonable interpretation is that we have to permit service animals. And because that is true, we are prudent to have a policy framework when we permit service animals.
I'd like to move this forward. I think there's a lot of wisdom in it. Gives us a way to keep disruptions minimalized too. It's good.
Yeah.
We've actually been seeing this in my day job, where some service animals are questionable character, that aren't as well trained as you would expect, and it creates disruptions within properties and has created tension. So I like the idea.
So do we through this policy, is there a requirement for, like, the service animal is trained certification or just by word of? So yes, that is there are standards, and there are standards by which we might exclude an animal. For example, if an animal is out of control and the handler or the trainer cannot control it, we can exclude that service animal if it's not housebroken, if it presents some kind of a health or safety risk to others. And there is language on page 3 and then continuing on to page 4 about the earlier question about conflicting disabilities. So again, it just gives us an opportunity to have a legitimate, consistent process.
But say the housebroken issue, do you find out after, or is there a way to find out before?
I believe we would be in a stronger position after. I will file this under questions I never expected to be asked.
I don't know if it passed through the state, but we tracked, there was a bill going through, and we found it intriguing that they're actually wanting to make it a criminal offense if you represent a dog as being a guide dog or a ability dog in public settings. And so, you know, when you're getting legislation at state level for the abuse, it tells you we've got a problem, that people just like to take their dogs to work. And so it was kind of an interesting to see. I don't know, did it pass? Some people smiled like they actually saw the legislation go through. I don't know if it passed though.
And at sporting events, I see it more and more, that I see people with their dogs at sporting events now. So I'll just be interested to see how this might affect some of that at some point.
I'd like to ask Bailey if she's, have you had service animals in any of your classes or any of your school settings?
Actually, yeah, but not with a student. A lot of parents I've seen, especially in the past 2 weeks, because of parents coming in for registration and stuff like that, have actually brought in service dogs. So I think it's a good idea.
How disruptive is that?
They seem well-trained. Like, they have the whole service dog thing.
They have the harness.
It stops at doors. I watched the lady take it throughout the school, and it seems fine.
What about cafeterias today?
I didn't ever see it specifically go into the cafeteria, but I feel like if it was properly trained, like if you've ever seen like a service dog in public, they're pretty well mannered, so I feel like it wouldn't be such an issue.
health issues with the dog being in our cafeterias?
I'm not aware of anything specifically. I'm sure we would get guidance on that from our nutrition services, but I do know that there are well-defined standards both for service animal behavior and for training of service animals, and our policy permits that. It's actually, schools are actually a very, very good setting to train service animals because they're controlled, and because a lot of what you're training especially a service dog to do is to ignore everyone except their companion or their handler. And so schools are, it's tempting because it's a dog and we love dogs and we want to go say hi. And good trainers are really assertive about making sure that the training experience is good for the animal, and you're training the community too. Both sides of that are pretty important.
And the handler / family that introduces the service dog is solely responsible for anything that service dog does, correct?
That sounds like a legal question, and I think it is complex enough that we want to have a policy framework in place. Because the number one question any civil court's going to ask is, did you follow your policy? That sounds like a legal determination, and I would want a legal professional to answer that question.
Okay, so it sounds like we're going to move these forward. Okay, so let's move these to the September 8th meeting as well, please. Okay, and then our general policy and procedure review, item 8, most of those were pretty small changes or redacting policies that are reflected in other places. Anyone have any questions on any of those? I know. Y'all are okay on policies on 8? Peanut gallery over there. Okay, then we'll move those forward, please, to September 8th as well. So we're on to item number 9, pay schedule for the limited employee compensation proposal. And that's Paul and Brett.
Brett Ridgeway, Chief Business Officer. This is a new idea in the spirit of innovation that we wanted to bring to you, and it's responsive to an issue that's really been present in our district for several years. And because of the way that traditional education salary compensation works with the structure of the schedule, we end up with having some people who get topped out on the schedule. And so then they end up being limited and actually basically frozen for that, beyond that point. Something I've always been a little bit uncomfortable with, but that's again the way our structure has led us to this point, you know, for several years until now. So we've taken an idea here that we've laid out to try and not have that literal freeze in someone's compensation just because they hit the top of the schedule. And have it tied to changes that we have in the rate of per pupil revenue. So it's not the volume increase, it's the rate. And so that's basically looking at someone's position and saying, we were willing to invest, X amount of percent or dollars in you in 1 year. Our revenue side is going to change in the next year, which is usually driven by something up close to inflation, right? So this is a way that we kind of end up are able to bring inflation back into it. So it's not the old COLA type of structure, which has its own connotations, positive and negative. So we're looking for something a little bit different here, but also to be able to say that an employee that, just because you were capped doesn't mean we value you any less, and we don't want to invest any less in you in these years after that. So that's kind of the gist of it. I think we don't have it here, I think, in terms of what we want to call that, but I think Paul's preferred nomenclature for it at this point is to have it a loyalty award. It will be a supplemental pay item for payroll purposes, so their base pay will still stay frozen, but the supplemental line is what will give them a chance or an opportunity to have some fluctuation in their pay. And this can go forward in time. And so it can be cumulative. If someone is frozen for a number of years, they can have the kind of a cumulative effect in the supplemental line that again reflects what happened in PBR. The other thing it does for us from the district's perspective is when we tie that to PBR, it kind of also protects our downside in case we have another recession, we have funding reductions, and that ends up in a reduction of funding rate. That also would come into play here. Of course, that's not our intention, but it is something we need to be of, so we don't dig a hole that we have trouble meeting in future years. So, Paul, anything else you'd like to say about? So again, it's a new idea we've been working on for a couple of months here, and wanted to bring that to you for consideration and guidance and thoughts, and before we would bring it forward for a formal vote. And you see in the lower left. I'm sorry, Mr.
That's okay.
We got right now. It says 17 employees. It's actually only 16 employees as we've further scrubbed that. So
that's okay.
There's some, but not a huge number that would be affected by this.
See, Matt. You know, even with it tied to pupil pay, mm-hmm. pay per pupil, is it really sustainable? Is there another way, like just giving them a cash bonus rather than tying them to their regular salary and having that compounded year after year after year after year, you know, which is eventually is going to cost the district more money?
Well, the sustainability time. Question is exactly why I wanted to tie it to the per pupil revenue rather than an outside measurement, like, you know, looking at inflation, you know, that was kind of independent of us, you know. So if we have it as tied into what how our revenue changes, then that kind of by definition keeps it sustainable is what I was aiming for.
Okay, so this would be a supplemental pay.
Mm-hmm.
And then if everything goes well, each year the size of that supplemental paycheck gets a little bigger because it's cumulative based on that time.
Right.
But then if we hit one of those, if we hit number one or number two, because number three is in the employee's control, but number one or number mm-hmm. two, does that mean that they're frozen at that supplemental level or that we don't necessarily issue a supplemental check?
We either don't necessarily issue the supplemental check or the value of it may just reduce.
Okay. So it could either stay the same, not be issued, or be reduced because either we didn't see an increase in rate or our fund account went down significantly.
Right. And so,
okay. So there's no commitment like 10 years from now, we can't, and they will understand that piece as well.
Yeah. There's no ongoing commitment anymore than what we have with compensation for employees who aren't limited. And in fact, this would be something that we would bring up in the early, you know, in the early discussions of budget years. We always talk about, okay, here's what's going to happen to revenue. So do we want to consider a step increase or not? This would come right into that part of that discussion then as well.
Because I think this is a really good idea. I like it. I just want to make sure that when we provide it, that we also make sure folks understand the caveats, because I want to believe we're not going to hit one or two. I don't think we're really going to have a problem with two long term. But number one, we don't have any control over again. And I don't want what should be seen as a goodwill and a reinforcement of your worth to feel if we hit that, if we have the negative thing happen, end up really being something that people interpret as something they were entitled to each year, and therefore we get a big backlash. And we're only talking about 16 people, but 16 people who've been really, really loyal and who've lived through a lot with us. I want to make sure that we do it right, and that we, so my request would be, let's just make sure they understand those caveats, because I think we need them. It's the only way it's sustainable. It's the right thing to do. But I would ask that we make sure that they understand it. You know, and their congratulations, you've reached the point where you get a loyalty bonus. Please understand this loyalty bonus is, because that's, you know, in the trade world, that would be they'd say, well, if our company revenues hit this point, then you get your bonus. But remember, it's a bonus. So, you know, as a mama, you don't put that in your budget line for everyday expense. We have to treat it as a bonus, and so I think it's important for this to be framed that way when it's explained. Does that make sense?
And just to be clear too, we're not intending this to be a lump sum bonus payment. This is part of a regular monthly payment as well. So it would just get added into the regular monthly check,
like part of the salary. So my thing is this overall funded student count, but what if the count of the students fall low for whatever reason, unforeseen reason?
Right.
So therefore, if the count of the students are low, that means there's less money for the district.
Right. And so that, and the reason to have those caveats in there is just really to have the same options, if you will, that we have for the entire staff. Right. Because again, if we have that conversation in the early spring of a year for the subsequent year, and we, for whatever reason, you know, suspecting that enrollment will go down, that will affect our decisions on stepping non-limited employees. And so we want to be able to just basically be very consistent in how we're treating going forward.
I'm curious, Brent, that for somebody to get capped, how long have they been with the district?
Well, you can see here in the right in the middle of the screen right now, these are the schedules, and this is where they stop right now. So you're talking 21 years at a minimum. Well, again, let me be careful with that. Steps are not equivalent to years. Okay. They often are pretty similar, if not literally the same, but that is not necessarily the same. If you were to interpret these as years, it would be 20 years. These are veteran employees, I guess would be the.
Well, the most answer. Credit we give isn't more than 10 at this point, usually, is it? We don't usually hire people beyond step 10 as teachers, I don't think.
Right, exactly. So we, you know, we can recognize up to 10 years. So it could be at say the 15-year mark of 15 years of service, but 25 years or more in the profession.
Well, I like it. To tell you the truth, and I just wanted to make sure it was sustainable. That's all.
Right. And again, generally, people wouldn't be in this situation for a whole long time either. It's probably a five-year window would be kind of be the average, maybe, if it's even that much, honestly.
Yeah, because if I can add a little bit, one of the things that I appreciate with this is Brett shared it with Peter and I, is a couple of things, because I have a couple of folks of mine that are involved in this situation. And really, one of the things that they really want to do is to feel that they are valued. And truly, when you have a veteran employee like that, they should be valued. And so I think the beauty of this is a way that they get to still feel that they're part of the entire valued team. And I think that, having two of the individuals that I've spoken to a little bit about it, they've always asked me, are we doing anything about it? And this is a way really where we are benefiting their value, but it does provide us the caveats if things are not hunky-dory, bless you, and we have to go the other way, then we're all in it together as well. And so I think that's the beauty of that. I really appreciate it. And the innovative way that Brett did this, I'm fortunate, having a financial background, I understand where Brett's coming from on this, but it's being able to see it from the employee's perspective too, because they want to at least feel that they're valued. And I agree that it's probably going to be for a short term for a few of the employees, because the two that I have are very close to, a potential retirement too. And the problem that I see with that is when you have a valued employee that leaves, the institutional knowledge that leaves. And so it's our way of at least, value that they are providing to the school district.
Okay, so is everyone good with moving this forward? Any questions?
I'd like to know how often someone hits a step increase. Is it every year? Is it automatic?
No, it's not automatic. That's part of what we bring to the board for decisioning as we consider a new budget proposal in the spring. Say, we do the math. Ron will do the math, say, here's what a step increase would cost for the next year. Do we want to propose that? And so that's the decision point that usually comes in the spring.
And then that is voted upon as applying to everyone, not
yes
individual employees.
Yes.
So pay schedules, basically we hire, it's based on the role and responsibility. And then they get a step increase based on whether the board feels they can afford a step increase. It's my less than first year on the board. So yes. I'm asking these things.
Yes.
What you're really asking for, you're saying, is a loyalty increase or a longevity increase? Is it more a longevity increase than it is?
Frame it that way. I think what we're trying to call it is in the loyalty award. I think it's just to basically indicate our gratitude in the length of their service to us.
Because they would be not allowed to get a step, right? So they would be frozen.
And why not increase the step schedule if it's going to be a given?
Well, I think that then has, that does have the compounding effect of it's a permanent increase to their annual compensation. And I think for, right. Yeah, we're committed to that. Yeah. And from my perspective, loyalty versus longevity is that I think loyalty implies contribution in some way more than longevity does. So that's why I like it better personally.
So then is loyalty more of a merit thing?
No, I don't think so. I mean, it is merit in the sense that in our proposal that performance is tied to performance. So a person could be, you know, one and two might be met. If number three isn't met by an individual, they won't qualify for the loyalty award.
And the conditions that you have are basically, this will be automatic. If we hit the condition, it's a yes. If we don't hit the condition, it's an automatic no.
And I think the way we're trying to frame this is that it's not automatic until the board approves it for a coming year. This is what would make it eligible to be considered.
Okay, so it's got to be considered and voted on every year then.
Yes.
When are you looking at putting this in effect? This calendar, this school year, or waiting another year?
Looking at putting it in effect right away. So my hope is that if we are able to process this in September.
Then I say yes.
Okay, so are we all okay with moving that forward?
Please. Evan?
Okay, John and Tammy, good?
Yeah.
Okay, and you're good, David?
Yes.
So yeah, let's put this on for action for September 8th, please. And so our final item, Chief Officer Reports.
I'll take the lead on it since Brett is up there. What I wanted to share with you a couple of things in the just some highlights from it is really a couple of things in the area of energy management. You'll get a little bit of still a little bit of Ron's thunder because he's actually doing a presentation. I believe it's going to be in October on this. But one of the things that was real interesting in reviewing the actual results of this past year, when Brett provided us the update on the energy management, I was extremely elated for that we actually finished the year in a positive way where we didn't overspend our budget. And part of that stems from a couple of things. One is that the rates, as you know, are continuing to increase almost every year. So what we've been able to do in a phenomenal way as a result of some of the capital projects we've done and some of the decisions we've made to include LED lighting and some of the automatic features that help us reduce our energy footprint from a consumption standpoint have been able to offset those rates, because we actually ended up the entire year with $120,000 positive that we in a positive way, and we didn't overspend. Because I think it was probably about December or January that I was looking at Ron and discussing this with him, and I was really worried that we were going to be on the other side of the fence. So I was elated when I actually saw Brett's report, and I went back and told Ron, I says, thank God you did all that stuff, because we didn't get, you know, have a $250,000 negative, because rates actually increased almost 13% on the utility side from a standpoint of electricity. So which electricity is a huge consumption of ours. Last thing I just wanted to bring up was that in Gene's report, there are three general education buses that are on order. They should be in the fleet, hopefully late September, early October, and then one special needs bus was also ordered in that. Hopefully that'll also be in place in October. And one other thing that Gene wanted me to add, because he's actually in Durango in a transportation leadership conference, but we ended up this year of actually adding one additional bus route. We had to change a couple of things because the first couple weeks of, or the first week or so of transportation was a little rocky, because in some of the areas, there were more students than we actually anticipated, and Gene's been able to mitigate most of that. And so he'll actually give his report. And that's one of the reasons why we moved his report to September, because he is gone this evening for that.
In the business office section, you'll see some things that you've seen in the past just with updated data, but I think you also see a couple of interesting things that you probably haven't seen before, especially in the accounting area, where Ryan's give you a preview of some information that will be published in the CAFR, Comprehensive Annual Financial Report, statistical section there. So you have a page in there that talks about the principal employers for the Pikes Peak region. That's some real good information, interesting information there. The largest taxpayers and property owners in the district is another one. And then we have also have some new slides from the purchasing contract management group, where we're listing some of the individual contracts and the numbers and the sizes we have and who those contracts are with in the district. Some good information for you. And then finally, in the planning department section, Melissa's put some information in there about military enrollments in the district, which is, again, some new data for you to look at and consider.
And those shifts will be positive. Who doesn't love a good CAFR? I mean, that's...
Yeah. Well, that may give Lou more than 10 schools that hit that mark, too.
That is correct, which is why Dr. Fletcher has set us up well to expand or extend the grant, the DODEA grant. In the Chief Education Officer report, you'll see a lot of detail. There's a lot of things going on as we start the year. I won't try and go through all the things, but there are a few things that are really exciting. One of them is that at our summer reading camp, where we have 6 weeks, we have three sessions of 2 weeks each, we had 208 students. We served 208 students. 77 of them had perfect attendance. That's a very, very big deal. They're there because they need to improve their reading performance. And from everything we've been talking about for 3 years, giving them the gift of reading as early as possible is noble. It's just worth doing. So that's very exciting for me to see that, proceeding forward. In part because of our work with primary literacy, when Colorado kicks off Literacy Week, which begins on the 26th of September, our new lieutenant governor is going to start the day here in District 49. She asked CDE, hey, where should I go and see people that are implementing the READ Act? And CDE recommended that she start the day here. So we're very excited about that. We're going to make sure that we show her the incredible work that our students and especially our teachers and interventionists are doing. So that's very exciting. Since we're talking about a political person in the district, I want to let you know that today we had a senior policy aide for Senator Michael Bennett spent the afternoon with us, particularly looking at career technical education and concurrent enrollment. So Director Mary Perez for CE and Director Nikki Lester for CTE spent the afternoon with me and with Senator's aide, Juliana Herman is her name. We visited PPEC and talked with Principal Dave Kanoki there, as well as Andy Franco, the zone leader. And then we spent some time at Patriot High School looking at their culinary CTE program, as well as their construction CTE program. We then went with Dr. Rourke to the Falcon Zone and visited with Cheryl DeGeorge and looked at all kinds of programs, but especially focused on our Health Sciences Academy at Falcon High School. So it's very exciting to have the opportunity to show somebody who is making policy decisions that have significant impacts on our flexibility. It was very exciting to show them what we've been able to do with current levels of funding and flexibility, and speak and illustrate what we would be able to do with increased flexibility. And we never mind some increased funding either. So those were just opportunities to celebrate the good work that has already been going on. I mentioned earlier about the cultural compass. I wanted to save this for here. I have a child at Vista Ridge High School. He's a sophomore. Two of his course syllabi came home with the cultural compass on it. Looks like Bailey has seen that in some other settings as well. Every single syllabus. That was not directed. That seems to have happened because teachers gravitated toward it and brought it up. So in some cases, I've heard students say, that's kind of weird. What is this? But I love that they're asking the question. And I love that our teachers are incorporating that. So that's very exciting. And then last thing, little bit personal. You guys have been very supportive of my involvement to learn how to be an examiner in the National Baldrige process. We have increasing our cohort of REMPEX, Rocky Mountain Performance Excellence trained examiners. So Mr. Anderson and Mr. Ridgeway and Dr. Rourke went through that training. Previously, Amber Wetstein and Matt Meister and Jack Bay went through that training. I've done the Baldrige leaders training, and I have an opportunity in September to participate in a site visit. So I'll be on a site visit team. Actually, so the big commitment, it means I'm away for a week. I will be only moderately available because as our examiners that have gone will tell you, they work you about 14 hours a day. But we know we have a super strong team here. There's no possibility that a ball will get dropped because we got great people here. And I just wanted to say thank you for the support. I intend to go and learn an incredible amount. My focus on this trip is workforce. So that's what I'm going to go learn about. I can't say who the candidate organization is or even where, but I can tell you I'm going to work hard and learn a lot.
You know, one thing I've mentioned in the report from the zone leaders is there's no consistency in what they report in each of their one-page little summary. And so it kind of makes it a little difficult to when you're trying to compare zone to zone and see different things. I don't know if it makes sense to anybody else to have at least two or three categories that are the same. So you're seeing a comparison between the zones instead of just a bunch of random stuff that I know they want to highlight what they feel is important in their zone. And so I'm not saying everybody should have the same, but it would be nice if there were a few categories that were across the board the same that you could kind of look at each month just to see something that's very similar. It's just me.
Well, I appreciate that feedback. We actually discussed this with the zone leaders at our last zone leaders meeting, actually education leadership team. And I brought it to Ms. LeVere-Wright as a question, and we would love to have input from the board about which parts of the education office report are helpful, which ones you want to always see, because we do have a lot of autonomy and it's reflected in the report, but we also want to have some consistency. So I would be very happy if you would look at this report or previous reports if you would like and say, that's a keeper. Yeah, that one didn't really float my boat. One of the things we know is that you seem to appreciate the mix of data and narrative. So we're moving to make that more consistent, but we haven't yet made the topics consistent. So if there are things that you would like to ask us to focus on, we'd love that feedback and we'd incorporate that into the future.
So do you all want to take a look at them and then maybe at the next, do you want to do it for September 8th or for September 24th, give them some feedback on what you'd like included in the future?
The 24th,
work session conversation.
Yes.
Okay, so let's do a
work session conversation.
If you want to give me suggestions outside of the board, we will begin drafting in response to that, and then you can say, yeah, you heard us, or no, you didn't quite get that right. So obviously we do things publicly, and we will present the new format and information publicly. But you can still start us working on that even sooner if you'd like to.
I must say, I do like the executive summaries that lead each of your reports. It really helps follow the rest of the report.
Okay, and so if that is it, anyone else have anything they need to bring up? And we are done for tonight.